Dear Esther, this cannot be the shaft they threw the goats into. It cannot be the landfill where the parts of your life that would not burn ended up. It cannot be the chimney that delivered you to the skies. It cannot be the place where you rained back down again to fertilize the soil and make small flowers in the rocks. I will hold the hand you offer to me, from the summit down to this well, in the dark waters where the small flowers creep for the sun. Headlights are reflected in your retinas, moonlit in the shadow of the crematorium chimney. Level 3. The caves. Dear Esther, did Jacobson crawl this far? Can I identify the scratches his nails ruined into the rocks? Am I following him cell for cell, inch for inch? Why did he turn his back on himself and not carry through the ascent? From here, this last time, I have understood there is no turning back. The torch is failing along with my resolve. I can hear the singing of the sea creatures from the passages above me, and they are promising their return to the gulls. Donnelly did not pass through the caves. From here on in, his guidance, unreliable as it is gone from me. I understand now it is between the two of us, and whatever correspondence can be drawn from the wet rocks. Donnelly's addiction is my one true constant. Even though I wake in false dawns and find the landscape changed, flowing inconstantly through my tears, I know his reaching is always upon me. It was as if someone had taken the car and shaken it like a cocktail. The glove compartment had been opened and emptied. With the ashtrays in the boot, it made for a crumpled museum, a shattered exposition. I first saw him sat by the side of the road. I was waiting for you to be cut out of the wreckage. The car looked like it had been dropped from a great height. The guts of the engine spilled over the tarmac, like water underground. They had stopped the traffic as far back as Sanford Junction and come up the hard shoulder like radio signals from another star. It took 21 minutes for them to arrive. I watched Paul time it to the second on his watch. There is no other direction, no other exit from this motorway. Speeding past this junction, I saw you waiting at the roadside. One last drink in your trembled hands. I'm traversing my own death throes. The infection in my leg is an oil rig that dredges black muck up from deep inside my bones. I swallow fistfuls of diazepam and paracetamol to stay conscious. The pain flows through me like an underground sea. If the caves are my guts, this must be the place where the stones are first formed. The bacteria phosphorescence and rise, singing through the tunnels. Everything here is bound by the rise and fall, like a tide. Perhaps the whole island is actually underwater. I'm traveling through my own body, following the line of infection from the shattered femur towards the heart. I swallow fistfuls of painkillers to stay lucid. In my delirium, I see the twin lights of the moon and the aerial shining to me through the rocks. In my final dream, I sat at peace with Jacobson and watched the moon over the Sanford Junction, goats grazing on the hard shoulder, a world gone to weed and redemption. He showed me his fever scars, and I mine. Between each shoulder, the nascency of flight. When I was coming round from the operation, I remember the light they shone in my eyes to check for pupil contraction. It was like staring up at a moonlit sky from the bottom of a well. People moved at the summit, but I could not tell if you were one of them. This is a drowned man's face reflected in the moonlit waters. It can only be a dead shepherd who has come to drunk drive you home. Level 4, the beacon. The moon over Sanford Junction, headlights in your retinas. Donnelly drove a gray hatchback without a bottom. All the creatures of the tarmac rose to sing to him. All manner of symbols crudely scrawled across the cliff face of my unrest. My life reduced to an electrical diagram. All my gulls have taken flight. They will no longer roost on these outcrops. The lure of the moon over the Sanford Junction is too strong. I wish I could have known Donnelly in this place. We would have had so much to debate. Did he paint these stones, or did I? Who left the pots in the hut by the jetty? Who formed the museum under the sea? Who fell silent to his death into the frozen waters? Who erected this godforsaken aerial in the first place? Did this whole island rise to the surface of my stomach, forcing the gulls to take flight? I sat here and watched two jets carve parallel white lines into the sky. They charted their course, and I followed them for 21 minutes until they turned off near Sanford and were lost. If I were a gull, I would abandon my nest and join them. I would starve my brain of oxygen and suffer delusions of transcendence. I would tear the bottom from my boat and sail across the motorways until I reached this island once again. Of fire and soil, I chose fire. It seemed the more contemporary of the options, the more sanitary. I could not bear the thought of the reassembly of such a ruins, stitching arm to shoulder and femur to hip, charting a line of thread like traffic spilled on a motorway, making it all acceptable for tearful aunts and traumatized uncles flown in special for the occasion. Reduced to ash, mixed with water, make a phosphorescent paint for these rocks and ceilings. We shall begin to assemble our own version of the North Shore. We will scrawl in dead languages and electrical diagrams and hide them away for future theologians to muse and mumble over. We will send a letter to Esther Donnelly and demand her answer. We will mix the paint with ashes and tarmac and glow from our infections. We paint a moon over the Sanford Junction and blue lights falling like stars along the hard shoulder. I returned home with a pocketful of stolen ash. Half of it fell out of my coat and vanished into the car's upholstery. But the rest I carefully stowed away in a box I kept in a drawer by the side of my bed. It was never intended as a meaningful act, but over the years it became a kind of talisman. I'd sit still, quite still, for hours just holding the diminishing powder in my palm and noting its smoothness. In time, we will all be worn down into granules, washed into the sea, and dispersed. Dear Esther, I find each step harder and heavier. I drag Donnelly's corpse on my back across these rocks, and all I hear are his whispers of guilt, his reminders, his burnt letters, his neatly folded clothes. He tells me I was not drunk at all. From here, I can see my armada. I collected all the letters I ever meant to send to you, if I'd have ever made it to the mainland, but had instead collected at the bottom of my rucksack, and I spread them out along the lost beach. Then I took each and every one and folded them into boats. I folded you into creases, and then, as the sun was setting, I set the fleet to sail. Shattered into 21 pieces, I consigned you to the Atlantic. I sat here until I watched all of you sink. There were chemical diagrams on the mug he gave me coffee in, sticky at the handle where his hand shook. He worked for a pharmaceutical company with an office based on the outskirts of Wolverhampton. He'd been traveling back from a sales conference in Exeter, forming a strategic vision for the peddling of antacid yogurt to the European market. You can trace the connections with your finger. Join the dots, and whole new components would be summoned into activity. There were chemical diagrams on the posters, on the walls, on the waiting room. He seemed appropriate at the time. Still life abstractions of the processes which had already begun to break down your nerves and your muscles in the next room. I crammed diazepam, as I once crammed for chemistry examinations. I am revising my options for a long and happy life. There were chemical stains on the tarmac, the leak of air conditioning, brake fluid, and petrol. He kept sniffing at his fingers as he sat by the roadside, waiting as if he couldn't quite understand or recognize their smell. He said he'd been traveling back from a sales conference in Exeter. He stopped for farewell drinks earlier, but had kept careful eye on his intake. He could hear the sirens idling above the idling traffic. Paul, by the roadside, by the exit for Damascus, all ticking and cooled, all feathers and remorse, all these signals routed like traffic through the circuit diagrams of our guts, those badly written boats torn bottomless in the swells, washing us forever ashore. When Paul kneeled over dead on the road to Damascus, they resuscitated him by hitting him in the chest with stones gathered by the roadside. He was lifeless for 21 minutes, certainly long enough for the oxygen levels in his brain to have decreased and caused hallucinations and delusions of transcendence. I'm running out of painkillers, and the moon has become almost unbearably bright. The pain in my legs sent me blind for a few minutes as I struggled up the cliff path. I swallowed another handful of painkillers, and now I feel almost lucid. The island around me has retreated to a haze distance while the moon appears to have descended into my palm to guide me. I can see a thick, black line of infection reaching for my heart from the waistband of my trousers. Through the fugue, it is all the world like the path I have cut from the lowlands towards the aerial. I will drag my leg behind me. I will drag it like a crumpled hatchback. Tires blown and sparking across the dimming lights of my vision. I'm running out of painkillers, and I'm following the flicker of the moon home. When Paul keeled over dead on the road to Damascus, they restarted his heart with the jump leads from a crumpled hatchback. It took 21 attempts to convince it to wake up. A sound of torn metal, teeth running over the edge of the rocks, a moon that cast a signal. As I lay pinned beside you, the ticking of the cooling engine and the calling from a great height, all my mind is a bypass. I've begun my voyage in a paper boat without a bottom. I will fly to the moon in it. I've been folded along a crease in time, a weakness in the sheet of life. Now you've settled on the opposite side of the paper to me. I can see your traces in the ink that soaks through the fiber, the pulped vegetation. When we became waterlogged and the cage disintegrates, we will intermingle. When this paper aeroplane leaves the cliff edge and carves parallel vapor trails in the dark, we will come together. If only Donnelly had experienced this. He would have realized he was his own shoreline, as am I. Just as I am becoming this island, so he became his syphilis, retreating into the burning synapses, the stones, the infection. Returning to my car afterwards, hands shaken and head split open by the impact. Goodbye to tearful aunts and traumatized uncles. Goodbye to the phenomenal. Goodbye to the tangible. Goodbye, Wolverhampton. Goodbye, Stanford. Goodbye, Cromer. Goodbye, Damascus. This cliff is slippery in the dew. It is hard to climb with such an infection. I must carve out the bad flesh and sling it from the aerial. I must become infused with the very air. There are headlights reflected in these retinas, too long in the tunnels of my island without a bottom. The sea creatures have risen to the surface, but the gulls are not here to carry them back to their nests. I have become fixed, open, and staring. An eye turned on itself. I have become an infected leg, whose tracking lines form a perfect map of the junction of the M5. I will take the exit at mid-thigh and plummet to my Esther. The stones in my stomach will weigh me down and ensure my descent is true and straight. I will break through the fog of these godforsaken pills and achieve clarity. All my functions are clogged. All my veins are choked. If my leg doesn't rot off before I reach the summit, I will be a miracle. There are 21 connections in the circuit diagram with the anti-lock brakes. There are 21 species of gull inhabiting these islands. It is 21 miles between the Sanford Junction and the turnoff for home. All these things cannot, will not, be a coincidence. Bent back like a nail, like a hangnail, like a drowning man clung onto the wheel, drunk and spiraled, washed onto the lost shore under a moon as fractured as a shattered wing, we cleave. We are flight and suspended. These wretched painkillers, this form inconstant. I will take flight. I will take flight. He was not drunk, Esther. He was not drunk at all. He had not drunk with Donnelly or spat Jacobson back at the sea. He had not careened across the lost shores and terminal breaches of this nascent archipelago. He did not intend his bonnet to be crumpled like a spent tissue by the impact. His windscreen was not star-studded all over like a map of the heavens. His paintwork etched with circuit diagrams. Strange fish to call the gulls away. The phosphorescent of the skid marks lighten the M5 all the way from Exeter to Damascus. Blind with panic, deaf with the roar of the cage traffic, heart stopped on the road to Damascus, Paul sat at the roadside, hunched up like a gull. Like a bloody gull. As useless and as doomed as a syphilitic cartographer, a dying goat herder, an infected leg, a kidney stone blocking the traffic bound for Sanford and Exeter. He was not drunk, Esther. He was not drunk at all. His roads and his tunnels and his path led inevitably to this moment of impact. This is not a recorded natural condition. He should not be sat there with his chemicals and his circuit diagrams. He should not be sat there at all. I have dredged these waters for the bones of the hermit, for the traces of Donnelly, for any sign of Jacobson's flock, for the empty bottle that would incriminate him. I have scoured this stretch of the motorway 21 times, attempting to recreate his trajectory, the point where his heart stopped dead and all he saw was the moon over the Sanford Junction. He was not drunk, Esther. He was not drunk at all. It was not his fault. It was the convergent lines that doomed him. This is not a recorded natural condition. The gulls do not fly so low over the motorway and cause him to swerve. The paint scored away from his car and lines like an infection, making directly for the heart. A gull perched on a spent bonnet, sideways, while the sirens fell to the middle distance, and the metal moaned in grief about us. I am about this night and walking, old bread and gold bones, old Donnelly at the bar gripping his drink, old Esther walking with our children, old Paul, as ever. Old Paul, he shakes, and he shivers, and he turns off his lights alone. I have run out of places to climb. I will abandon this body and take to the air. We will leave twin vapor trails in the air. White lines etched into these rocks. I am the aerial. In my passing, I will send news to each and every star. Dear Esther. I have burned my belongings. My books. This death certificate. Mine will be written all across this island. Who was Jacobson? Who remembers him? Donnelly is written of him. But who was Donnelly? Who remembers him? I have painted, carved, him, scored into this place all that I could draw from him. There will be another to these shores to remember me. I will rise from the ocean like an island without bottom. Come together like a stone. Become an aerial. A beacon. That they will not forget you. We have always been drawn here. One day, the gulls will return and nest in our bones and our history. I will look to my left and see Esther Donnelly flying beside me. I will look to my right and see Paul Jacobson flying beside me. They will leave white lines carved into the air to reach the mainland, where help will be sent. Dear Esther, I have burned the cliffs of Damascus. I have drunk deep of it. My heart is my leg, and a black line etched on the paper all along this boat without a bottom. You are all the world like a nest to me, in which eggs unbroken form like fossils. Come together, shatter, and send small black flowers to the very air. From this infection, hope. From this island, flight. From this grief, love. Come back.
Locked Into Vacancy is produced in collaboration with Stories Telling Stories and STS Media Group, socially isolating itself at Milhouse Studios in Milton, Vermont, casting around the globe to your frontal lobe, wherever podcasts are found. Locked Into Vacancy is also streaming on YouTube at Stories Telling Stories. Make sure to give us a review wherever you stream our show. We really appreciate it. Make sure to follow us on Facebook and Instagram, give us a subscribe on YouTube, and consider supporting us on Patreon for exclusive rewards starting at $1 a month or more. And until next time, stay sane, stay safe, get vaccinated, and stay whimsical.